first heard about the moon hoax conspiracy theory, I thought it was a joke. Something from a Monty Python skit, maybe. I could not believe that there were people in this world who took this thing seriously. I was wrong. Then, I just assumed, as most faithfully and observant propagandists out there, that we would eventually send probes to the moon and send back images of the Apollo landing sites, and that would finally silence the moon hoax conspiracists. After all, even Bill Kaysing, the founding father of the conspiracy theory, said that when we did that, he would admit he was wrong. Well, after the release of the LRO photos in July 2009, it didn't take long for the diehard conspiracists to claim that those photos are all fake too. And Jarrah is producing a new series of videos on YouTube to lead the attack. The purpose of his first video in the series, LRO, Selene, and Clementine, is to discredit the photo of the Apollo 15 landing site. His strategy is to pitch it against earlier photos of the landing site taken by the Clementine and Selene Kaguya spacecraft. Did he accomplish his mission? Let's take a look. Following the opening sequence, which I love in all of Jarrah's videos, Jarrah begins with a space.com article from 2001, which talks about a geological study of the moon led by Dr. Kozlovsky of Brown University, not NASA, which used photos from Clementine. In this study, the geologists, scientists, were trying to identify fresh impact craters by looking for the minerals that the meteors left on the lunar surface after their impact. In one of the photos produced by the study, they found a small dark spot that wasn't associated with any crater, but coincided exactly with the already known location of the Apollo 15 landing site. The spot, the scientists theorized, represents an alteration to the lunar surface that was created by the lunar module's descent engine when it landed. The article also states that none of the other Apollo landing sites has this anomaly. With this photo in mind, Jarrah turns to the LRO photo and asks, if this photo shows the Apollo 15 landing site, then where is the oh-so-obvious disturbance that the propagandists have hyped about? Jarrah then goes on to say that it's important to note that the Clementine images were recorded in the ultraviolet spectrum, and that's why the splotch representing the Apollo 15 landing site comes out black. And if the image had been recorded in the visible light spectrum, the anomaly would have come out much brighter. To demonstrate this, he shows a negative of the image. I don't understand why Jarrah considers any of this important, because it's not correct. There is no correlation between what an object looks like in visible light compared to UV. To explain this, consider the common honeybee. As everyone knows, honeybees have compound eyes that contain three classes of retinal photoreceptor cells. These cells have a maximum sensitivity to light at 540 nanometers green, 440 nanometers blue, and 350 nanometers ultraviolet. Under ultraviolet, some flowers, like the Mimulus shown here, have a darker pistil, where the nectaries are located. That makes it easy for the honeybees to find the nectar guides by using their ultraviolet receptors. Notice that in the visible light spectrum image on the left, both the petals and the pistil are yellow. In the UV spectrum image on the right, the petals are light, meaning they reflect the ultraviolet, while the pistil is dark, meaning it absorbs UV. This contrast is invisible to the human eye. All we see is the image on the left, a yellow flower. Now, Clementine was designed for geological exploration. It had several cameras designed specifically for its mission. One, the UV visual camera, had a six-position spectral filter wheel. One filter was centered at 415 nanometers with a bandpass of 40 nanometers, covering the spectrum from the upper end of UVA to violet. Another filter passed 750 nanometers with a 10 nanometer band, red to near IR. Those two filters are at opposite ends of the visible spectrum and extend just barely out on both ends. The camera also had 900, 950, and 1000 nanometer filters, all with 30 nanometer passbands, all in the IR spectrum. Each of these filters was sensitive to certain types of minerals. The sixth position, in case you're wondering, was a broadband filter. It passed 400 to 950 nanometers, covering the visible spectrum and some IR. Although the 415 nanometer filter dips into the near UV range, the article clearly states that the photos that the scientists studied were taken with the red filter. My guess is they're talking about the 750 nanometer filter, just because I know that's the band that's most sensitive to iron, and the major source for iron on the moon is what? Meteors. The same meteors that created the fresh impact craters that the scientists were looking for, right? The point we need to emphasize here is that the study was not a hunt for Red October. They weren't looking for the Apollo 15 or any other Apollo landing site. We already know where they landed. The purpose of the study was to look for mineral deposits on the moon. The black spots in the photos they studied represent a local abundance of iron oxide. That's all. The article doesn't explain any of that, of course. It doesn't go into that kind of detail. The article is poorly written, it repeats the same phrases several times, and lacks any technical quality whatsoever. It doesn't even qualify as science for the masses. I can't fault Jarrah for missing a little detail like which filter was used, but there is one detail from the article that Jarrah overlooked that seems rather important to me. The scientists studying the Clementine photos were looking for geological evidence that you can't see in normal visible light photos, or even in the original filtered images sent back from Clementine. The scientists mentioned in the article were developing a method for identifying fresh impact craters from the photos. If it were as easy as just looking at a raw image, they wouldn't have needed the study. The image presented in the article is a processed image. They state that in the article itself. It's obviously not an original Clementine image. And if you don't believe me, all you have to do is go out to the JPL library and search through the Clementine images. You can find literally hundreds of photos taken of the same area as the photo in the article. Of course, you have to create a negative of those photos to get anything closely resembling the photo in the article. But even doing that, there's not one that looks just like the article's photo. I didn't go through all of them, of course, but none of the 95 published photos that I viewed had any distinct black spots anywhere near the Apollo 15 landing site. So apparently, as the article states, the photo in the article was a composite of 52 different photos. At least that's the gist of the story. Take it or leave it. Basically, it's a type of false color image. Normally, when someone says false color image, you think of color ratio images, where each channel, red, green, blue, is a ratio of two images from different frequency bands. This image is also a false color image, but since it's in grayscale, I'm assuming it's a color difference image. They processed images under two different sets of conditions, then they took the difference and bumped up the contrast. It was rendered as a negative image, so that the areas of interest are dark. What this means in simple English is that you won't see the black spot in any unprocessed Clementine photos, or in any LRO photos, or in any other photos. Let me say that again. You cannot make a legitimate comparison of this false color Clementine image to any visible light images from the LRO or any surface photos taken by the Apollo astronauts. The Clementine argument is now debunked. 1 point, Phil. That's it for now. We'll leave our review of Jarrah's use of the Selene Kaguya photo to discredit the LRO photo of the Apollo 15 landing site for part two. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.